Good morning, YouTube. So I wanted to show you this ice maker control module working here. So I have a test set up. I've got my Cliff quick test here, and that's plugged into an isolated AC power supply. So I've got the line and neutral and earth connections hooked up to the back side of this control module. To make this work, what I've done is I've put a switch here plugged into the thermostat or bimetal switch connections here. So this is the T and H test points, but this switch simulates the bimetal switch here that closes when it gets below 17 Fahrenheit or minus 8 Celsius, and then it opens above freezing point, so above 32 or 0 Celsius. Yeah, so what I've done is I have a little piece of wire in here so you can see the motion of this ice level sensor. So normally you would have that wire bale that's in your ice maker plugged into the back side, but I wanted to plug it in the front side so you could see it going. Let's say you just installed it, and I'm gonna close the Cliff quick test here, and you can see nothing's happening. It's just sitting there. It's taking zero current. There's no current on the meter. It's just sitting there. Now this switch, like I said, represents this bimetal switch. So you just put this ice maker in the freezer. It's room temperature. Over maybe half an hour or an hour, this is going to cool down, and pretty soon that switch is going to close, and now you can see that dial starts moving. This indicator light is hooked up to the heater output. The controller is turned on the heater, and the heater is going to remain on until the thermo switch here warms up above the freezing point. So let's say the switch now closes, the heater is shut off, and it's just going to roll around here. So what's happening now is your ice ejector is in the back of this, and it's slowly rotating, and it's pushing the ice cubes out of the tray. So like, here's your ice cube tray, and this ejector is rolling through, lifting the cubes out of the tray after the heater has been run to warm this up to release the ice. And this wheel takes about 3 minutes to fully rotate. So it's driven by this synchronous motor that's up here, and then it's geared way down because you need enough torque to push the ice cubes out of the tray. Again, that's the heater light. This is the water valve. So you can see the water valve is lit up, and that'll stay on just for about 7 seconds. So that's filled the ice cube tray. Yeah, now my wire was a little bit stuck, but if you watch here, that's gonna drop. I think I've got something binding up my cam back there. But anyway, it's gonna cycle around and stop right back here where it started. And now it's waiting for the bimetal switch here to close to indicate that the ice is frozen. So let me flip this over so we can watch that same thing from the backside. So open up my tester here. I just wanted to show you, this is the side you would see looking in the freezer if you pulled off the cover. Yeah, and I think I had something. Oh, okay, yeah, wires were bound up in the cam mechanism here. Okay, I think I have everything set up now, so you can see my test setup. I've got the Cliff quick test over here, which has the power feeding line and neutral, the black and white wires. I've got the earth wire hooked up. This indicator light is my water valve, which is connected up here, and then the heater coils are connected up here. And that's this indicator light. So you've got your synchronous motor, there's the cam mechanism, this black wire here, twist tie, is representing the bale that checks if the ice cube tray is full. And then down below I've got my switch that's simulating this bimetal switch. So actually, let me lift this up. I'll close the switch because with my setup here, I can't get to the switch underneath when it's running. So anyway, again, you've maybe just filled the ice maker with water and it's sitting here waiting for this to freeze. Now I just closed the switch and I'll turn the power on here. And you can see there's the heater running. Now you can't really see this turn. Let me actually shove this in here. Here's your ice ejector. You can see how it's slowly rotating. This ejector now is trying to push the ice cubes out. And this heater will actually stay on most of the cycle if that switch here doesn't open up. So since I'm just leaving that switch closed, the heater will actually just stay on for a long time, which is one of the reasons there's this thermal overload here in the wire harness. So this thermal overload is clipped onto the side of the ice cube mold. And if the heater stays on too long, it's going to overheat this and it will open the circuit and cut off power. So that's a safety feature. That's where the thermal overload clips in there, right next to the heater coil. But you can see now it's lifting this ice sensing bale. If you look here, the cam has lifted that plastic lever up and it's riding around slowly. So it lifts that up and then it gets over to this point and it's going to drop that bale. There you saw the thing drop off the cam, and then pretty soon the water valve will turn on here. I think I know what's keeping this off is that the thermo switch is closed, so it never runs the water valve at that point. So let me open the power here because I have to pick this up to operate my switch. So let's open the switch now and let's put power back on. And you can see now the heater light is off and this thing will run through another cycle. So you basically have to lift the bale up, you drop the ice in the bucket, and then you drop the wire bale down. If it goes all the way down, this thing will do another cycle. If it doesn't go all the way down, it stops. And there you can see here's a fill cycle because now I've opened the heater switch. So it says, oh, I can make ice because this thing is working. So it's going to go down here and pretty soon it's going to drop and it'll roll around just a little bit longer and then it shuts down. This bimetal switch is important for having the heater turn on and off. But if this switch fails, the water valve will never turn on because the controller is saying, hey, if this switch is stuck closed, there's something wrong with it. So don't keep pouring water in. There's something wrong with the unit. So that's actually a neat little safety feature because otherwise this thing would keep going through the cycle. And if this switch had failed, it wouldn't know it when there's water and when there's ice. So yeah, that's what controls that. So there's a lot of logic built in here on this wheel inside. As this piece here rotates, there's also a copper contact wheel underneath that's rotating along with this. And then you've got these sliding contacts here. Let me open up the power so I don't short anything, but you've got sliding contact there. There's one there. There's one right under here for the water valve. So this is where the water fill adjustment screw would normally go in. And you can see they've built in flex into the copper strips here. So there's a vertical strip that kind of acts like a spring, and then there's these two pieces that capture the threads of the adjustment screw, and as you turn that screw in or out, it moves this piece of copper in or out. And underneath here, just under the arm, is one of these sliding contacts, just like this one, except you're moving that contact in and out. And that contact moving in and out moves it along this slot. So I think this is the way it comes in here. So it comes in, turns on the water valve. So this is roughly 7 seconds long to rotate this far. So you can imagine that sliding contact is coming along here. It turns on and then it turns off. If you slide the contact farther out, it turns off quicker. If you slide the contact in, it turns off later. So that gives you about a second of adjustment there. So that's quite a clever design. I mean, they built this whole timing adjustment feature into the copper pieces that they cut out and bend and then fit into this plastic housing. There's nothing separate here. It's not a separate component. It's just a piece of copper that's bent and formed just the right way. And then there's a little plastic screw that goes in there. And that is your timing adjustment. And because this is a synchronous motor turning at a known speed, you can get quite repeatable time settings here. And then the water fill valve that's down in the bottom of your refrigerator has a fairly calibrated flow rate, so that 7 seconds here equals so many milliliters or ounces of water in your ice cube tray, which just fills it to the right level so that you get the same size ice cubes every time. So right here, these are the contacts for the heater. Those just plug right into these formed copper pieces that act as connectors. So there's no separate connector here. It's just a piece of formed copper, and you plug that pin off of the heater in. Likewise, here's the grounding pin that plugs in way up here. So it's really incredible. There's no connectors here. So they've formed every little piece of copper and bent it just right and made it so it just plops into these recesses in this plastic module. And then you've got this cam gear here that operates your sensing bale. And then this is also your manual override if you wanted to shut the ice maker off. So if you lift the ice maker bale all the way to the top, this thing gets shut off, and there's actually a pair of contacts right under here that open. So once you do that, that clips over this little pin here and holds it. So as you bring that down, that thing will click into place and the ice maker is basically shut off. They're using the same ice maker bale that automatically senses the ice level. That's your on-off switch. So there's no separate on-off switch. So everything on this board does multiple functions. This version of the design was done in the late 1980s. And this whole board is robotically assembled. Everything is punched in from the back side, and the only thing that's on the other side is the big plastic gear. So yeah, this one, there's the two wires on the motor. There's two screws that hold the motor in. And then everything else is punched into place. The copper is punched in. Here's your adjustment, water adjustment screw. Here's where they form the connector. So this is just a vertical piece of plastic with some copper shoved in there. And then you've got this connector here, and this just slides over like that, and you've got a connector. So there is a connector on this end, but there's just a piece of plastic and some copper on this end. There's no separate part number for the connector. It's just part of this assembly. Really brilliant design. This is really cost reduced, and it's quite reliable because here, for instance, you've got these sliding contacts, and you have to realize this thing is inside your freezer. Every time you open the freezer door, there's going to be warm, humid air come in. It's going to condense on any metal surfaces like these traces. It'll freeze into frost. any sort of normal contacts would get iced up. Any sort of circuit traces, like if this were a flat circuit board, you would get ice buildup that could bridge between two traces. But you can see how they've recessed everything, so they've really taken safety into account here. You've got great separation because this whole board is live at mains voltage. But on this side that you see, there's nothing conductive. It's all plastic insulated. So yeah, that's the Whirlpool Modular Crescent Mold Ice Maker. And that's the control board. Yeah, so this is kind of the support piece that goes in between the control module and the ice maker mold. You've got your bimetal switch here. I guess one thing you won't see on here, there's no resistors, there's no capacitors, there's no transistors, MOSFETs, microcontrollers, there's no power supply, there's nothing active on this board. There's a motor, and you've got a bimetal switch. That's it. Just really impressive design. And the original design of this, we'll take a look at in the next video, was done probably in the early 1950s. So this basic ice maker has been around for about 70 years. So anyway, if you have any questions about that, or if you know any of the history of these things, who designed it, or if you've got any personal knowledge or any links you can share, go ahead and post that up in the comment section below. I'll post some of the information I have found in the next video, but it's a little sketchy. There's just not a lot of information about this thing out there. Yeah, maybe we can learn some more about it. So stay tuned for the next video. And in the meantime, thanks for watching.